We welcome everyone to our morning worship on this Sunday, March 25th, 2023, as we continue our journey in the season of Lent. We will begin with the singing of Holy, Holy, Holy. Sister Penny Liggins will do our call to worship. Our opening hymn is number one in the AME hymnal, O For a Thousand Tongues to Sing. And in the absence of exhorter Larry Jones, I would like to ask Sister Dolores Carter to do our opening prayer. Our scripture will be read by Sister Denise Freeman, the summary of the Decalogue by Sister Deborah Uzzle. And then after that, Sister Freeman will return for the announcements, followed by the altar call. Let us stand. Holy, holy, holy.
The place where thy honor dwelleth.
For the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
So sing unto the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things.
Music in the sea. we thank you for all that you've done for us over the last week, since we last met. We present ourselves to you this morning with all of the problems of life that we have, and we hope that somehow you will solve all of our problems for us. Health problems, financial problems, whatever we have, we rely on you, your guidance, your strength, and whatever it takes to help us with our life and, as we live it. We pray for the sick and the shut-in. We pray for those who are incarcerated behind prison walls. We pray for those who are in nursing homes, those who are, as our Sunday school said this morning, those who are prisoners of their own mind. We pray that we get a connection with you, and that all of these things will be taken care of. We pray for those that are here. We pray for those who are not here. We pray that somehow something will reach them and they will see the need to come and worship you in spirit and in truth. We pray for our country. It seems to be every day we look at something different. If somebody else is killed or things happening everywhere, we can't solve all these problems by ourselves. We need your help.
Yes.
And we pray that you will, in your own time, will help us solve our problem. We pray for this service, that it will go just exactly like you want it to go.
Yes.
And when it's all over, we pray for a safe journey back to our home. We ask all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Scriptural responsive reading. We will be reading from Genesis 20, verses 1 through 18. Genesis 20, verses 1 through 18. And Abraham journeyed from thence toward the south country, and dwelt between Kadesh and Shur, and sojourned in Gerar.
And Abraham said of Sarah his wife, "She is my sister." And Abimelech the king of Gerar sent and took Sarah.
But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, "Behold, thou art but a dead man, for the woman which thou hast taken, for she is a man's wife."
Abimelech had not come near her. He said, "Lord, wilt thou slay also a righteous nation?"
Said he not unto me, "She is my sister"? And she, even she herself, said, "He is my brother. In the integrity of my heart and innocency of my hands have I done this."
God said unto him in a dream, "Yea, I know that thou didst this in the integrity of thy heart, for I also withheld thee from sinning against." Therefore Abimelech rose early in the morning and called all his servants and told all these things in their ears, and the men were sore afraid.
Then Abimelech called Abraham and said unto him, What hast thou done unto us? And what have I offended thee, that thou hast brought on me and on my kingdom a great sin? Thou hast done deeds unto me that ought not to be done.
And Abimelech said unto Abraham, Why sawest thou that thou hast done this thing?
And Abraham said, Because I thought, Surely the fear of God is not in this place, and they will slay me for my wife's sake.
And indeed she is my sister. She is the daughter of my father, but not the daughter of my mother. She became my wife.
And it came to pass, when God caused me to wander from my father's house, that I said unto her, This is thy kindness which thou shalt show unto me. At every place whither we shall come, say of me, He is my brother.
And Abimelech took sheep and oxen and men servants and women servants, gave them unto Abraham, restored him Sarah his wife.
And Abimelech said, Behold, my land is before thee, dwell where it pleaseth thee.
And to Sarah he said, Behold, I have given my brother 1,000 pieces of silver. Behold, he is to thee a covering of the eyes unto all that were with thee. Thus she was reproved.
So Abraham prayed unto God, and God healed Abimelech and his wife and his maidservants, and they bare children, and together.
For the Lord had fast closed up all the wounds of the house of Abimelech because of Sarah, Abraham's wife.
Amen.
Thank you.
Good morning. Our announcements for the week are as follows. Excuse the typo in your program. Today it's not March 25th, it's March 26th. Sunday, March 26th. On March 28th, Tuesday, will be the dedication of the bronze of G.W. Jackson at G.W. Jackson Legacy Park on the corner of Martin Luther King and Fifth Avenue. That will begin at 11 o'clock a.m. And there will be a luncheon at the Cook Center to follow, and that begins at 1 o'clock p.m. March 29th, Bible study will be at 6 o'clock p.m. By phone, and the number is up there in the Bible study listing every Wednesday at 6 o'clock p.m. April 2nd, next Sunday, is Palm Sunday. April 6th, the Way of Messiah Fellowship's 5th Annual Passover Cedar and Community Meal will take place at First Methodist Church here in the city from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. April 7th, that's Friday, Good Friday, the Seven Last Sayings will take place at Wayman Chapel A&E Church in Temple, Texas, beginning at 4 o'clock p.m. April the 8th is the 2nd Northwest Texas and WMSYPD meeting. And this meeting will be in person here at Bethel A&E Church. We have 9 to 12, those are our hours of plan, but the meeting will start between 9:30 and 10 o'clock. On April 9th, which is Easter Sunday, following our Easter service, we will have the egg hunt immediately following. April 18th is our third quarterly conference. That's on a Tuesday at 8:30 p.m. And I would like to get those reports by either Easter Sunday or the Wednesday following, the 9th or the 12th. April 23rd is the Zerubbabel celebration that will take place here at the church. And April 30th is our 5th Sunday WMS program. We have some additional announcements. The Navarro County Early Childhood Coalition, in honor of Child Abuse Prevention Month, join us for an early development instrument map gallery walk. It's what this is called. Light refreshments will be provided. This is on Monday, April 3rd, 2023, from 4:30 to 6:30 p.m. It's a come and go event at the Warehouse Living Arts Center lobby. They have a gallery exhibit there. You can bring your headphones to listen to them. The gallery walk will share school readiness data gathered and neighborhood mapping of Navarro County kindergarten students. Hear from ECC members about what we are doing to improve readiness. If you are unable to attend the opening, the maps will be available for viewing at the WLAC from April the 5th through the 7th from 12 to 5 p.m. And then we have an announcement from Pelham's Women's Ministry, Wesley United Methodist Church, and Brown Chapel African Methodist Episcopal. This is an Easter crazy bunny hats and tea brunch on April the 8th, 2023, from 9:30 a.m. to 12 o'clock p.m. 9:30 to 10, there'll be a continental breakfast. Registration is $3 a person. It will take place at the Pelham Community Center in Pelham, Texas. Ladies, don't forget to wear your hats. Their guest speakers will be Pastor Brenda Sellers of Christian Lighthouse in Hubbard, Texas, and First Lady Christine Daniels of Greater Mount Hope Baptist Church in Mount Calm, Texas. Following that will be judging of the hat as well as door prizes. And those are all the announcements that I have, Reverend Melson.
I've asked Danny to pass out the lesson for Wednesday night. Questions and answers. We'll be studying Revelation chapter 9, the blast of the seven trumpets, part 2, as we continue this journey through the book of Revelation, a very interesting book. Does anybody else have any announcements? Well, do we have any prayer requests? Yes, Sharon.
Well, I lost my cousin on Friday. My cousin, she passed away on this past that's right. And then I'm asking for prayer for my aunt, because she's coming home on hospice tomorrow.
Amen. Where'd your cousin live?
In Coffin.
In Coffin. Well, keep us posted about that. We recently, a lady we knew in Coffin, Sister Joyce Ann Jackson, a long time member of Macedonia AME Church where we were for 8 years, had passed away. That was a few weeks back. I don't know if I mentioned that or not, but let's continue to pray for that family as well. As well as for Sharon's family and her aunt. Let us pray for Sister Ozel. She went to the knee doctor the other day and had a little scare. She thought she might have a blood clot. Tests were done, and praise the Lord, no blood clot.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. She still has a number of procedures to go through. I have a Facebook friend who lives in South Carolina, Joan Durham Ferrer, is having heart surgery tomorrow. So let's lift up Joan. She's a wonderful Christian lady, and she has faith that God's going to get her through. She's in her 70s now, so age does complicate things some. But regardless of which age you are, be assured God is still with you. We live in a culture that almost deifies youth. And it's good to know God doesn't abandon us when we get old. Praise the Lord. Praise His holy name. Any other prayer request? Well, let us stand for prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you for letting us come here again to Bethel, the house of God. We've been through many trials and tribulations. We've had our share of setbacks and disappointments. But by your grace, we're still standing. I know you're not through with Bethel. And I pray that you will make us the church you'd have us to be, truly the house of God. I pray for everybody who's here today and their loved ones. Give them a blessing for Sharon's family, for her cousin, for their loss, and for her aunt. And as a family deals with the difficulties they're facing in hospice, I pray your presence might be felt as never before. Pray for my wife and all others who are facing procedures. I pray for Sister Joan in South Carolina that you'll be with her. Give her your blessings. Empower her. Bring her through the procedure successfully. And may she be able to lift you up and praise your name as a result of your healing. We know you're still in the healing business. We know you're able to heal. You're able to set free. You're able to deliver. We call upon this today. We pray everybody here, you bless their jobs, bless their marriages, bless their homes, bless their finances, and help us to reach out, Lord. We know that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. Truly, you've given us the ministry of reconciliation, and may we never fall short. In Jesus' name, amen. Now have our Black History moment.
Architect who designed several notable buildings
Baptist Church and the nearby Denwood Chess House in the Denwood neighborhood of Washington, D.C. He was the son-in-law of Booker T. Washington. Pittman was born in Montgomery, Alabama, to an ex-slave laundress and a prominent white man of that city. At the age of 17, Pittman attended Tuskegee Institute, where he completed programs in woodwork and architectural mechanical drawings. In 1897, he was awarded a scholarship to attend the Albright Drexel Institute in Philadelphia, where he completed the 5-year architectural and mechanical drawing programs in only 3 years, graduating in 1900, after which he returned to Tuskegee to teach for the next 5 years. Pittman designed a number of buildings for Tuskegee, including the Colin P. Huntington Memorial Building in 1900 to 1905. He then moved to Washington, D.C. and developed his own successful practice, receiving many important commissions. He developed the Fairmont Heights housing development for blacks in the suburb of Maryland. In 1907, he married Portia Washington, the daughter of Booker T. Washington, and the family home that Pittman designed in Fairmont Heights was a notable landmark. Pittman won a federal commission for the Negro Building at the Tercentennial Exposition in Jamestown, Virginia in 1907. He designed the Colored Carnegie Library of Houston, built in 1913 as the only library available to African Americans of that city. Pittman then moved to Texas in 1913 to escape the influence of his famous father-in-law. Once in Texas, Pittman built the St. James African Methodist Episcopal Church in Dallas, the Allen Chapel AME Church in Fort Worth, Texas in 1914, and the Joshua Chapel AME Church in Waxahachie, and the West Chapel AME Church in Houston in 1926. In 1928, after raising 3 children, Pittman and his wife and separated. She returned to teach at Tuskegee, and he quit the practice of architect and began working as a skilled carpenter. For most of the next 2 decades, he published an opinionated and controversial weekly paper titled Brotherhood Eyes. Voice in the African American community that was an alternative to the mainstream newspapers such as the Dallas Weekly or the Dallas Express. In the paper, he attacked what he saw as a failure among the local preachers and other black leaders, gaining him many enemies. Pittman died March 14, 1958 in Dallas, Texas, where his key is buried in Glen Oaks Cemetery. William Sidney Pittman.
The building downtown Dallas that Pittman designed that once housed the Grand Lodge of the Knights of Pythias is still standing. It was last report it was unoccupied, but There was on the building the name of the insurance company that was once there, Union Banker. There's a marker in front of the building. It told an interesting story that in 1919, the Jubilee Singers from Fisk University in Nashville performed there. Tickets were 25 cents. Reserved seats, 50 cents. In that same building, the Grand Lodge headquarters, there were doctors, lawyers, and dentists that had their offices, so it was pretty prominent at one time. And William Sidney Pittman was certainly an outstanding architect and an outstanding individual. Praise the Lord. Do we have a song from the gospel choir?
To Calvary.
Haven't played guitar much lately and was having trouble, Danny, keeping it in tune. The other day when Waxahachie, I decided to take it by the Ellis County Music Center, and within a few hours they had it fixed.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Good,
you been there?
Yes.
Oh, good.
Right there, 35, right?
Yep.
Yes, sir.
And God said unto him in a dream, Yea, I know that thou didst this in the integrity of thy heart, for also was held thee from sinning against me. Therefore suffer thee not to touch her. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, help us to understand the meaning of dreams, your forgotten language. In Jesus' name, amen. Dreams, visions, prophecies, and other communications from God are different ways in which messages from the spiritual realm, which some call the unconscious, break into consciousness, where they can be comprehended and where they can be acted upon. The most common of such phenomena is the dream. Scientific research has revealed that dreams occur during a state of sleep called REM, rapid eye movement, which is very different from other levels of non-dreaming sleep. Considerable evidence indicates that one of the primary reasons why we need to sleep is so that we may dream. When we go to sleep, we give our unconscious a chance to work, and thus messages can come through. If we don't sleep much, we don't dream much, and it's to our detriment. The ability to dream, like the ability to draw or paint, is a gift of God. Just think about that.
Amen.
The ability to draw or play or paint, the ability to play music, whatever one is able to do. If one's able to fix an automobile or do electrical work or plumbing or whatever, whether people acknowledge it or not, those things are gifts of God. Amen?
Amen?
And the ability to dream is a gift of God. All God's gifts, without exception, can be abused. Now, you can use music for a good purpose or for an evil purpose. You can use art for a good purpose or an evil purpose. You can use dreams for a good purpose or an evil purpose. God will one day hold us all accountable for the stewardships of all our gifts. God gives us time. How we use our time, our success or failure in life, a lot of it has to do with the way we use our time. Have I ever wasted any time? Of course I have. I've probably been as guilty of that as any person that's ever lived. But I repent, I regret it, and I strive to use my time better. So teach us to number our days, that we might apply our hearts unto wisdom. And wisdom comes from God. We're stewards of our gifts. Some people dream more than others. There are some people who seldom, if ever, dream. That is a fact. And some people remember more details from their dreams than others. Since the mid-80s, I've been keeping detailed accounts of my dreams and have several pretty good-sized volumes on them. I don't know if I'll try to publish them someday or not. Maybe, maybe not. But a lot of them are interesting. And all dreams do not come true. Thank God for that. I've had plenty of dreams I sure don't want to come true. And you may be planning on taking a particular course of action. You may be planning on doing something that you should not do. You have a dream. That dream shows you the disastrous results of what your plans are. So you change your plans. And you avoid something disastrous. Isn't God good? Isn't that wonderful when He does that? Stops us before it's too late. There's no master key to dream interpretation that will explain everything every time. There's a whole slew of books out there about dream interpretation. And so they're interesting to read. But there's no book that's going to tell you everything there is to know about every dream. Ha, this is the way you interpret it. No, it may or may not be that way. It depends on the context. It depends on the person. It depends on the circumstances. A lot of factors enter into it. So there's no master key. Nevertheless, I believe dreams are truly God's forgotten language. That God still speaks through dreams today. Amen? In the summer 1984 issue of Spirituality Today, Philip St. Romaine wrote a very interesting article entitled Dreams and Christian Growth, in which he observed, during the past century, physiologists and psychologists have done considerable research into the phenomena we call dreaming. People concerned about a Christian spiritual life, moreover, have found dreams in their interpretation of means of discerning God's will, and thus a more intimate communion with God. The purpose of this article is to sketch the basis for this view of dreams and their interpretation as significant for Christian discipleship. In the spiritual life, we are called and empowered by the Holy Spirit to relate the whole of our lives, their conscious as well as their unconscious aspects, to God. Of course, we seek to discern God's will for us in the external circumstances of our lives. For example, a sick child to be cared for, a massive world hunger to be relieved, ignorance of God's saving work in Christ to be replaced with knowledge of the gospel. We can seek to discern God's will for us also through the dreams we have. Our lack of Christian love and the proliferation of sin which follows and makes life miserable can be discerned through dreams. Possibly our dreams may reveal to us psychologically healthy tendencies which deserve to be fostered consciously so that we may love ourselves, neighbors, and God more adequately as Christians. A case can be made, therefore, for attending to our dreams as a means of growing in Christian discipleship. The Bible has a lot to say about dreams. As today's text tells us, God warned Abimelech in a dream and thus prevented a disaster. One of the most famous dreams recorded in the Bible is found in Genesis 28, verses 10 through 22. Then Jacob departed from Beersheba. He went toward Haran. He came to a certain place and spent the night there, because the sun had set, and he took one of the stones of the place and put it under his head and lay down in the place. He had a dream, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth with its top reaching to heaven. Behold, the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord, the God of your father, God, Abraham, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give it to your and your descendants. your descendants will also be like the dust of the earth. And you will spread out to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. In you and in your descendants shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you. I will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. He was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God, the gate of heaven. So Jacob rose early in the morning and took a stone that he had put under his head and set it up as a pillar and poured oil on its top. He called the name of that place Bethel. However, previously the name of the city had been Luz. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me, and I will keep and will keep me on this journey that I take, and will give me food to eat and garments to wear, and I return to my father's house in safety, then the Lord will be my God. This stone, which I set up as a pillar, will be God's house, and all of that you give me, I will surely give a tenth to you. God took care of him, and for the rest of his life, he paid his tithes faithfully. John 31:13 describes a later dream of Jacob, in which the Lord told him, I am the God of Bethel, where you anointed a pillar, which made a vow to me, now arise, leave this land, and return to the land of your birth, the God of Bethel, house of God. Jacob's son Joseph was one of the great dreamers of the Bible. According to Genesis 37:5-11, and Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him even more. He said to them, please listen to this dream which I have had. For behold, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf rose up and also stood erect. Behold, your sheaves gathered around and bowed down to my sheaf. Then his brothers said to him, are you actually going to reign over us? Are you really going to rule over us? So they hated him even more for his dreams and for his words. Now he had still another dream, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars were bowing to me. He related it to his father and to his brothers, and his father rebuked him and said to him, what is this dream that you have had? Shall I and your mother and your brothers actually come to bow ourselves down before you to the ground? His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the saying in mind. Such jealousy caused Joseph's brothers to sell him into slavery in Egypt. But what they meant for evil, God used for good. As Joseph became prime minister of Egypt and the chief grain merchant who prepared the land for the coming famine. While in Egypt, Joseph became quite adept at dream interpretation. In Genesis 4:5-8, we read, then the cupbearer and baker for the king of Egypt, who were confined in jail, both had a dream the same night, each man with his own dream and each dream with its own interpretation. When Joseph came to them in the morning and observed them, behold, they were dejected. He asked Pharaoh's officials who were with him in the confinement of his master's house, why are your faces so sad today? They said to him, we have a dream and there is no one to interpret it. Then Joseph said to them, do not interpretations belong to God? Tell it to me, please. The ability to dream is a gift of God. The ability to interpret dreams is also a gift of God. In the following chapter, in a conversation with Pharaoh, Joseph again gave credit to God and not to himself for the gift of dream interpretation. If only today we would acknowledge that every gift, talent, ability would have come from above. We don't have anything of our own. It all comes from God. As my late father-in-law used to ask, who woke you up this morning? Amen? Never will forget that. Who woke you up this morning? He knew the Lord woke him up and woke everybody else up. We need to acknowledge that fact. And Genesis 41:25-32 provides the following details. Now Joseph said to Pharaoh, Pharaoh's dreams are one and the same. God has told to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years. The dreams are one and the same. The seven lean and ugly cows that came up after them are 7 years. And the seven thin ears scorched by the east wind will be 7 years of famine. As if I have spoken to Pharaoh, God has shown to Pharaoh what he is about to do. Behold, 7 years of great abundance are coming in all the land of Egypt. And after them, 7 years of famine will come. All the abundance will be forgotten in the land of Egypt. Famine will ravage the land. So the abundance will be unknown in the land because of that subsequent famine, for it will be very severe. Now, as the repeating of the dream to Pharaoh twice, it means that the matter is determined by God, and God will quickly bring it about. Job, the suffering righteous man, was frightened by dreams and terrified by visions, according to Job 7:14. Elihu, one of Job's friends, said to him in Job 33:15-16, in a dream, a vision of the night, when sound sleep falls on men, while they slumber in their beds, then he opens the ears of men and seals their instruction. The prophet Jeremiah, confronted by the dreams of false prophets, and believe me, there's a lot of false prophets around today. He was inspired by God to proclaim in chapter 23, verse 28, the prophet who has a dream may relate this dream, but let him who has my word speak my word in truth. According to Daniel 1:17, God gave to Daniel and his three friends knowledge and intelligence in every branch of literature and wisdom. And Daniel even understood all kinds of visions and dreams. It is amazing how rulers who do not know God, when they are disturbed by their dreams, they turn to the men of God for interpretation. And thus, just as the Pharaoh of Egypt turned to Joseph, so Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, turned to Daniel. Later, Daniel himself had a dream and visions in his mind, so he lay on his bed of things that would come to pass, soon come to pass. Daniel 7 contains a summary of this dream. Last year, we had a very interesting study of the book of Daniel, in which all that was covered. A very important dream played a role in the events leading up to the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Let us take heed to Matthew 1:18-25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. And Joseph, her husband, being a righteous man and not wanting to disgrace her, planned to send her away secretly. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you will call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Now all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall be with child, and shall bear a son. They shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated, God with us. And Joseph woke from his sleep and did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took Mary as his wife, but kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. The following chapter of Matthew contains the account of the visit of the wise men who had seen the star in the east, had come to worship him. Verse 12 of this chapter tells us that they were warned by God in a dream not to return to Herod, and thus return home by a different route. According to Matthew 27:19, when Pontius Pilate was sitting on the judgment seat, contemplating whether he would sentence Jesus to death, he received a message from his wife, who urged him to have nothing to do with that righteous man. For last night I suffered greatly in a dream because of him. The Apostle Peter, in his sermon on the day of Pentecost, as recorded in Acts 2, 14 through 21, quoted the predictions of the prophet Joel in chapter 2, verses 27 through 32. Thus you will know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and there is no other. My people will never be put to shame. I will come about after this, that I will pour out my spirit on all mankind. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions. Even on the male and female servants, I will pour out my spirit in these days. I will display wonders in the sky, and on the earth blood, fire, and columns of smoke. The sun will be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And it will come about that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be delivered. For on Mount Zion and in Jerusalem there will be those who escape, as the Lord himself said, even among the survivors whom the Lord calls. Thus we see that God spoke through dreams many, many times in the Bible. There's no reason to believe that God does not still speak through dreams today. Dreams are indeed God's forgotten language. For those in our live service and those in our virtual audience, we again ask you today to turn to Christ. If you want to have meaning of your dreams, if you want your life to be fulfilled, turn to him today. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Let us stand.
I'm satisfied just to kind of be.
We will now worship God with our tithes and offerings. Do we have any other word at this time? Easter in 2 weeks. Praise the Lord. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Spake unto him in a dream, Lord, help us to realize the reality of dreams as your forgotten language. In Jesus' name,
Amen.
You're dismissed.